and all that I am, I never hope to be. See, I owe it all.
Happy Sabbath, everybody. Once again, we've come through another week, and the Lord has blessed us, and He's kept us. And we're so thankful of what He has done to bring us to this point. I welcome you again to Sharon Seventh-day Adventist Church. Happy Sabbath to you is what we say each week. And it's just a reminder that we come together at this appointed time to lift up the name of Jesus. Of course, all week long, we've been celebrating with one another on the telephone. We have a 12 noon service that we call and just check in with each other. And as it's been for the last couple months now, the church is empty, but we're here, and we're happy that you're joining us wherever you might be. Welcome to the month of May, and a new month, and I pray, and as you're praying, that we're closer to the other side of this pandemic. I pray that God has kept you safe and kept your family members safe, and if you've encountered any sorrows this week, just remember that earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. So welcome again to our service here at Sharon. I'm Pastor Michael W. Dyson. The W stands for Wayne, Michael Wayne Dyson. That's what my relatives call me at home, back on the home front. But just happy to be with you once again and remind you that if you want to listen in, you can do so by calling in on our teleconference number. It's listed on the screen there, along with the code that's right behind it. So 563-999-2090. And then there's a code that you have to put in, 435-402. And that code will allow you to listen in to the service, even as you are listening and watching. We are reminded that we're broadcasting today not only on Facebook, but we're using YouTube. And they have been very good during this period of pandemic where we can't come and be among each other. We're blessed to have this, blessed to have an opportunity to still come together. 2020 for us at Sharon, we've set it. We started this year off with the mindset that we're ready for Jesus. And so the question was being asked, are you ready for Him? And we're doing whatever we can to bring closer to Him this year, as well as our prayer time. And every Sabbath morning, it would normally be here in the sanctuary, but it's virtual, where you can call in at the number that we have. And at 8:45, you can listen to our prayer service. And even on the weekdays, from Monday through Friday, we have a prayer initiative at 12 noon that you can call in, that same number, and just check in with each other. We bring in some of our elderly who haven't had a chance to be at the church. And we just dial them in and bring them in on the prayer line, and they're thrilled. They're able to hear us, what we're doing is praying for them, but they're able to hear it for the first time and be able to share, and people are so happy to hear the voices of those that we miss coming out each week here. At 4 p.m. today, it's a full day. We've had not only our prayer this morning that began at 8:45, we had our Sabbath school, which is doing a great study on the scriptures. And then this afternoon at 4 p.m., we will have our spiritual growth. Every Sabbath, every Saturday we do that. And it gets into detail, and you can ask all kind of questions. We got some wonderful teachers that are able to just dialogue with you. And then for those who are looking to do something a little different, this coming week will be the National Nurses Appreciation Day. We recognize our nurses. And so this Sabbath, our conference has got a little lead on it. They're going to have a virtual appreciation of our nurses. They're going to gather together. I've got nurses in my family. My bride is a nurse, and many of you have those folks that are going into harm's way to take care of us. And we want to certainly appreciate them, not only on their day of May 6th, this coming Wednesday, but we want to pray for them even today. We're happy to have you with us again. Happy Sabbath, everybody. God bless you, and let's worship Him today in spirit and in truth. God bless.
The world needs to know about this.
We set our work aside.
Leave our cares behind.
We leave our cares behind on this day of Sabbath rest.
It's the holy made a memorial to creation.
On this your holy day,
we come
to give you praise on this day of Sabbath.
All right, we need some sharing harmony right here. Come on, everybody.
Holy rest. And those who worship normally with us here at Sharon, we love to sing that song together. You're hearing it recorded each week now that we're away. But I know our family members are singing it even in their homes, singing it wherever you are. It is the best part of the week, and it's the best time when we come together, even in this virtual mode of worshiping Him. Our affirmation of faith, and I hope you have your Bibles today. If you have your Bibles, I'd ask you to open your Bible to the Gospels and go to John chapter 3, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. And in my Bible, it says this: "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." John 3:17 says, "For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." Oh, those are power words. And then not only do we have our affirmation of faith, but we have our belief in the fact that God has made this a gift for us by Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. Go to the book of Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. And it says, "For by grace are ye saved, through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." Oh, thank you, Father, for bringing us together once again.
This is what it's all about. It would be all right if he changed my name. I told Jesus it would be all right if he changed my name. It would be alright. Oh, I told him it would be alright. And I told Jesus it would be alright if he changed my name. Sure, and you were born
This has been a trying week for many. We've had loved ones that we have seen exposed to this virus, this unseen enemy. We've even had loved ones that we've lost this week. I, with you, this last Sunday, we gathered together right here in this place, only very few that could come in, as we said goodbye to one of our dear members. And we're still lifting up her family, the McDonald family, even today. And then there is someone that, even though I had not met them in person, and it's a strange feeling. It's, many of you experienced it at the beginning of the year when we lost basketball great Kobe Bryant. And many of you have never met him, but it just felt as though we knew him, even when we found out that he had died. And so this week, when I heard of the passing of a gospel artist, Troy Sneed, it impacted me. I love this music. And I just love anybody who can sing praises to the Lord and do it in such a way that it's heartfelt. I want to pray with you this morning. It's prayer time, and that's one of the main reasons that we come out. The Lord said himself, it says, my house shall be called a house of prayer. And so many of you have been praying. Many of you are praying even now. And so I just would like to come alongside you as we pray together this morning. Precious Savior, Father, our Lord, Redeemer, Prince of Peace, Father, so many names that we can call to describe who you are. We have learned that you are the Lord of mercy and the Lord of comfort, even so much that you've given us a helper, a comforter, and Lord, we're grateful for it. Even now, there are those who are needing to feel the arms and feel the love of the comforter after having lost a loved one. Father, we thank you for being a helper. We thank you for being present with those who are alone. Father, we've learned that this pandemic has not been very good to our elderly. Many have perished in nursing homes when their families could not even come to touch them one more time. Nothing so distressing as not even be able to say goodbye properly and not even be able to funeralize or to be able to just share those normal emotions that one would have when a loved one, a dear one, is lost. Everything about Jesus and his life here on the earth was to show us that he is not distant from us and he has experienced what we've experienced. God the Father experienced that when his son was given and lost. Separated from the Father for the first time. And so because he knows that feeling intimately, he is able to do what no one else can do.
He is able to comfort a mother. He's able to comfort a child. He's able to draw a family close together. He's able to give those words of assurance because he's true to his word. And so we come once again together in this place, calling on the Redeemer, calling on the name of the Lord. Our word shows us that when his children cry, he hears us. Oh, thank you, Lord, for being a God who's ever present. We ask you to be with us now, and we ask you to lead us and guide us as we move forward in this service. Lord, we just praise your holy name. We ask you to forgive us of our weaknesses and forgive us of our sins and continue to draw us near you. We ask this prayer in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. I hope your week wasn't too tremendously hard, and I hope you were able to deal with all of the things that this extended period of quarantine and separation brings. It's unusual for us because whether people know it or not, we are social creatures. And one of the things that we love even here at Sharon is the ability when we come in the door to hug somebody and to just greet somebody. And now with this distance that must be imposed, it's difficult. But we have a God who is with us, and because of that, we love him, and we give unto him because of what he does for us. So when we give tithe and we give offering, it is returning. We don't pay tithe at this church. We return unto the Lord what is his, and we do it because he gave first. He gave his son. He gives his love. He gives you the ability to earn whatever you have. All things belong to him. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. And so for us to even be able to give a little bit, all we really have to give is ourselves. And so we come and we give, and at Sharon we've made it so that there's at least four different ways you can give. You can mail in your offering. You can use the online services that we have. We have a text service where you can text it in and text it to Sharon SDA at 77977. And then I'm so thankful that every Sabbath we have our head deacon is standing by, and he's standing at the door with mask and gloves. And for those who want to just drop off, you can drop off your offering between 12 and 2 p.m. We're here. And then on Wednesday evenings between 11 and 1, those can come by the church and drop off your offering. And then just be reminded with this services that we have, you can give anytime, anywhere. You can be a part of this and just giving back to the Lord. And for whoever is able to give, we simply say thank you. Thank you for what you do. Thank you for being so willing to be obedient to God. And again, we wish you a wonderful and happy Sabbath. I am so tremendously excited today through this medium of technology. I've got what I call my sister. This is another sister in my family. Who has blessed our hearts for many years. And she is willing. I talked to her and I said, Kim, would you be willing to sing for us today? And so we have special music coming all the way from Ohio from a gospel recording artist. Many of you know her as Kim Palmer Washington, but she's a married girl now. And so the next voice that you'll hear is that of Kimberly Palmer Blackwell. I hope and trust that you'll be blessed by her. God bless you as we worship him today.
Good morning, Sharon Seventh-day Adventist Church. I've counted a privilege to be with you all this morning, right here coming from my home in Atlanta, Georgia. I want to let you know that we serve a great God, and he promised to take good care of us because we're going to see a better day after a while. Better day after a while, go. gonna be a better day. A better day. Ooh, child, it'll be a better day. Day after a while. Better day. Oh, after a while, it's going to be, oh, a better day, yes. Ooh, child, it'll be a better day, day after a while. I'm gonna trade all my troubles in for a lifetime of smiles, and I'll forget how hard it's been to run these last few miles. Then when Jesus says to me, "Kim, welcome home, my child," oh, the bitter heartaches will surely be worthwhile. Better day. Oh, after a while, it's going to be a better day, yes. Ooh, child, it'll be a better day, day after a while. I'm gonna trade all my troubles in for a lifetime of smile, and I'll forget how hard it's been to run these last few miles. Then when Jesus says to me, "Welcome home, my child," oh, the bitter heartaches will surely be worth a while. Better day. Oh, after a while, it's going to be, yes, a better day, yes. Ooh, child, it'll be a better day, day after a while. This is what I like about the song. I'm gonna ride on the rainbow road, travel up the Milky Way, and I'm gonna live in a home where I have no more rent to pay, no more snow, no more rain. Lord, a clear sunny day, but Lord, I pray the coming of the day when I will fly away.
Praise the Lord for that music. It still touches my heart, and I hope that it's touched your heart as well. I hope you were blessed by that, inspired by that here on this Sabbath day. Awesome. We have great musicians here at Sharon as well, and I told Richard Mosley, I said, "Man, I don't hear you singing as much as I used to hear you sing." Richard is actually here in the place, and I, you know, sometimes I like to put people on the spot, but I just love hearing him play. You know, sometimes you just want to take and just have a service with nothing but music. And he's able to do that because he's able to not only play but sing. And we got a powerful praise team that is normally here. And we just worship the Lord here at Sharon. And we've learned a long time ago that you can't move forward unless you do something about the past. You can't move ahead unless you bury the past. And so today I'd like to talk about that. A sermon title, if I were to have one, I would call it Burying the Past Successfully. Burying the Past Successfully. Father in heaven, we again ask you, Lord, to be with us as we open your word. Bless us now and as we spend time with you here. There is a sweet, sweet spirit in this place, and I know that it's the Spirit of the Lord. The sweet Holy Spirit, sweet heavenly dove, stay right here with us and fill us with your love. And for these blessings, we lift our hearts in praise. Without a doubt, we'll know that we have been revived when we shall leave this place. Be with us now and lead us. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Here we are in the second month of quarantine, and for many it's been longer. Here we are now in a time of moving on, and people are studying the Word of God. Remember, we said that God has not only paused the world so that it is able for us as Christians to take time to read, but God has also given time for the world to get a deeper sense of what He is calling on us. And for many, what has begun to happen is people are beginning to reconnect. People are beginning to rekindle their relationship with God. People are beginning to study the Word of God again. And so the questions are being asked, and you'll hear the preaching of it today and even tomorrow. What happens after the storm? Where do you go after the pandemic? When you've gone back to having a deeper relationship with the Lord, you've listened to people who have prayed, you've joined into prayer groups, you have been had your heart rekindled, and now you want to do something different. You don't want to go back into a normal stance the way we came into this period of quarantine. And as states are beginning to loosen up restraints, you can see the traffic is beginning to build up again. You're seeing people beginning to go to the stores. Now, of course, we still have to wear the mask and gloves in many instances, but people are beginning to slowly come out of their slumber. And so what happens next? Where do we go next? If, in fact, the Lord has paused the world for the world to listen to him, a world that may have possibly not been in tune with him, the question is, what do we do next? And the question is really geared at those who have begun to read the Word of God again, those who began to go to prayer meeting on a Wednesday night again, those who began to be in prayer groups and studying at home on their own, realizing that we're in a time where you must reconnect with the Creator. And so we begin to wonder, what is the next step? And for many of God's children have done it, they've already gone through, and they understand what God has called on us to do, and that is to follow Jesus every step of the way. We can't feel the pool behind us yet. Baptism is always a special time at Sharon and at many churches. It is the rebirth. It is the chance for people to go in, and the old man is laid aside, and they become a new creature. God has promised that. And so I want to talk today about the next step for those who are considering baptism. You see, baptism is mentioned about 80 times in the New Testament, and so we want to just take this time of study, and for those that know, those who have been baptized recently, God bless you. You know the challenges that once you've come out of the water, that you must still stay connected with the Master, that being baptized is not the end. It is only the beginning of strengthening the relationship with Him. The word baptism itself, the question is, what does it mean? There's a Greek word called baptizo, and baptizo means to dip or to immerse or to plunge under the water. And that's very important because there are some people who have tried to change what baptism really is and the method of doing it, but there's only one method, there's only one Lord, there's only one faith, and only one baptism. And God has declared that. Baptism is a burial of our sins in the watery grave. It is following what Christ did, who went to the grave and rose from the grave. And so baptism is following His actions. Baptism is doing that. Here's what Romans 6:34 says, 6:3 and 4, I'm sorry. Don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus was baptized into His death? That's what baptism is. It is following the Master. That's what Jesus did. Jesus died for us. And so when we die to our sins, when we die to the old life, the old man, and something happens when you get baptized, something happens, there's a change that comes about. And that change is only impacted if you allow the baptism to go in the phases that He has. You know, there's justification, and that's when you accept the Lord as your Savior. And then there is the period of sanctification. And in the Bible, John 17:17 tells us that sanctification is sanctified by the word of God. So once you have gone into the water, that doesn't mean that you come out and you say, all now I'm waiting for is translation. All now I'm waiting for is the Lord to come. No. Sanctification is a lifelong process. Baptism is the beginning, and then from that you start this new way of life. And then there's the third part. You've got justification, you've got sanctification, and then, of course, glorification. That will come when Jesus comes. We're in the sanctified period. We're being sanctified by the word of God, and we're being redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I've often said about the Bible, if you take it, and it's all of its intensity of 66 books and just broke it down to four chapters. Now, the four chapters are real easy. The first chapter is creation. In my Bible, the first thing it says in Genesis, in the beginning, God. And then not very shortly after the creation of man comes the fall of man. In the garden in Eden, man fell. And so you got creation, and very shortly after, we have already fallen. And then the third of four sections, if we were to put it in sections, the first one would be creation, the second one would be the fall, and then the third one would be redemption. And that's what God is trying to do. That's what this time is all about. You want to know why the Lord has delayed His coming? He's trying to redeem us to Him. And I praise God that He's delayed His coming. I praise God that He's allowed time for as many as can be saved that will come. And that's why we sing, we're redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. It's the blood that flowed. It's Jesus' blood that we're redeemed by. It's Jesus' blood that we pray to be covered by. It's Jesus' blood that's on my doorpost so that this unseen enemy can pass by. And so creation, the fall of man, and then there is the redemption that God is trying to redeem us back to Him. And the last part is consummation. And that's really for Christ and His church. Christ is the bridegroom and the church is His bride. And so when the redemption period is ended, He is going to come to a church that He seeks, a church without spot or wrinkle. And on His celestial clock, God has a timeline. His ways are not our ways, neither His thoughts are our thoughts. And when God says He's ready, He's coming for His church. Romans 6:3 and 4 shows that baptism is important. Here's what it says. We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. Come on, somebody. You need a new life. Ain't no way you're going to go through this tunnel of a pandemic and come out on the other side the way you went in. Something has to change. Something in your life has to be different after going through what we've been going through, and we're still not out. But there is a period of pausing that God has allowed the world, has allowed you, so that you can open his word and begin the process of change. Jesus is the resurrection, and he was resurrected to a new life, and we're resurrected to a new life in Christ Jesus. That's what the Bible tells us. Jesus often in parables sit on the Mount of Olives, and here's what he said to those disciples of his, and he's speaking to us today. If you are a disciple of Christ, if you go by the title of Christian, then you're a follower of the Christ Jesus. And in Matthew 28, 19 and 20, before he left, he gave instructions. He said, go therefore make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And then he goes on to tell you, teach them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And then he gives that caption, and lo, I am with you always, even until the end of the age. Amen. You ought to say amen on that. We got a God that's going to be with us even to the very end. So when we think of baptism, and I know we have some Bible scholars, although I personally don't believe there's any Bible scholars, because every time I open the Word of God, it's still brand new. No matter how many sermons you've had, it's interesting when you hear someone preach a word and then someone else will come back and take a scripture and can glean something entirely new out of it. And you go, where did they get that? And if they're true to the word, I'm not talking about these people that add their own flavor, because the Bible says if they speak not according to this, it's because there's no light in them. And my Bible tells me that Jesus is the light of the world. So let's rephrase that. If they speak not according to this, it's because there's no Jesus in them. But there's an illumination of the word, and I've been sharing with my family, my church family, that during this time of quarantine, and the word of God is medicinal. It is powerful, because it's not regular word. This is not a regular book. If you look at it as a regular book, it's because you have not come to it in the way that he's asked you to come. You need to come in the power of the Holy Spirit for understanding. Sometimes people want to bring in their own interpretation of the Bible. And let me tell you something today, friends. The Bible interprets itself. But with the power of the Holy Spirit, it will illuminate your mind. There is nothing deeper than the Word of God. I used to hear guys, man, even on the corner, the guys, they'd be drinking, and when they try to get deep, the only deepest thing they could do is throw a little scripture at you. Most of the time, it was very similar to what the enemy of God would do with Christ on the peak. They would quote scripture, and many times they were incorrect in their the way they quoted it, but they were trying to get deep. And there is nothing deeper than the Word of God. What the Word of God does to those who truly become students of it, it levels the playing field. That's why you can have a grandmama who didn't have a college education, and grandmama couldn't read anything else, but she could read the Bible, and you couldn't understand why. That's why those who are not PhDs, and there's nothing wrong with education, don't get me wrong, but by having an understanding of the Word of God, it gives you a level of intelligence into the Word that it opens your mind. And so Jesus gave instructions before he left. He told us, he said, I want you to go and baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Nothing more spiritual to those of you who've had the opportunity to go in the water
with someone who is being baptized. I've seen teenagers who, you know, in their coolness and have committed to go all the way. God bless their heart, and they're, you know, kidding a little bit with their friends, and their friends are just amazed that they're going all the way. And something happens when they get into the water. I've seen it. It's like something unseen, and all of a sudden they begin to get still, and tears begin to come down their eyes. And the Spirit of the living God begins to truly work on them, and they realize that this moment, in this water right here, heaven is open, and heaven is watching. I've had the pleasure over years to be in prison ministry. Those of you who know me, you know I've done prison ministry for years, been with some wonderful prison ministry teams, and not everybody is able and willing to go behind those prison doors. But going behind the prison doors, and I can remember of a prison down in Virginia, and there was a young man, and these are people that not have been in there a couple years. These are people that have been in there 10, 20, 30 years. And there was a young man, I call him a young man, but he had been a part of one of these national gangs and that go by the colors and all that. And even in the prison, even inside the prison, he was respected. So we would go into prison, and they would have a time when they would play some music, and they even had a prison choir in there, and the men would give testimonies, and I would always watch this young man as he would come in, and he would be at the back of the chapel. And after a few times of going down there, a few months of going down there, he listening to others give their testimony, and then he stood up to give what he thought was his testimony. And I could just see the respect on the other inmates who had been there for years. They got quiet as he would begin to speak. Tattoos all along here that would come down the side of his face and down on his side, and he had tattoos all over the place. But something was happening to him. And we watched him as he would begin to move from the last pew in the chapel. And before long, he was moving forward. And before long, after a 5-6 month period, he took his stand for the Lord. Now, there's something that happens when you take your stand and you want to get baptized in prison. It's different. They don't have a big pool, at least in the one we were at. And anyone who's done prison ministry knows what they do is they will bring out a little, it looks almost like a coffin, to be honest with you, fill a pool with where the inmate can step up and step into the water. And it's not a lot. I can't go in the water with them, but I can baptize them. And I remember when this young man decided to go all the way, tattoos and all. I remember him being willing to follow this God, and the water was ready, and we did the singing at the institution, and the inmates were clapping and everything, and now was his time to step up and step in. And I stood on the side, and I tell you, when you're a part of that, it impacted me probably even more than him. As I'm looking at him in the water, I'm wondering, what kind of God can do this, can take somebody from a whole different lifestyle and be able to penetrate and be at a place where they can hear the voice of the living God and change begin to happen. And as he's in the water, and as we're reading the word of God before I begin to take him down up under the water, I saw the tears begin to come down his eyes. And I guarantee you, there wasn't a man in there, and there's about 30 or 40 others. There wasn't one in there because they respected him. There was nobody in there making any other faces. They too were amazed that if God can change him, what can he do to me? You see, baptism is got steps, and the steps of baptism are like this. The first one is you got to repent. Repent is a genuine sorrow for your sin. And you're just sorry, Lord. I'm sorry for what I've done. Repentance is what John the Baptist talked about. It's what Jesus talked about. You got to repent. And number two, you got to believe. You got to believe in acceptance of Jesus, both as Savior and as Lord. And then after that is the instruction. You got to learn. That's the sanctification part of being sanctified by the Word of God. Instruction in the essentials of biblical faith. Repentance is number one. In fact, in the book of Acts, chapter 2, verse 38, it says this: repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now, that is a powerful verse right there, because we've had big discussion. Does that mean before you get baptized, you don't have the Holy Ghost? I'm looking at the scripture. The scripture says that be baptized, everyone, in the name of Jesus Christ, not only for the remission of sins, and then it says, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. That would take some study and some time to understand that. There's a lot of folks who refuse to be baptized. And there are some instances, let me say right now, where people cannot be baptized, either by their health or their frailty of their body, or even in a time like this. Listen to me. Right now, churches cannot baptize like we normally could. Our church is empty. But see, the first thing that happens is that, number one, once you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are justified. If you want to see it, go to Romans chapter 5, verse 1. It talks about that. So you must repent, and you must be baptized, and the gift of the Holy Spirit is sent your way. Then number two, you got to believe. He that comes to the Lord must believe that he is. Here's what it says in Mark chapter 16, verse 16. Whosoever believes and is baptized, look what it says, will be saved. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. Does your Bible say something like that? I hope it does. It talked about the eunuch and those that understand his story. It's a powerful story that happens. And the eunuch is someone who's taking care of the queen's money. And he's come alongside, and he's been reading about this Savior. He just doesn't understand who he is. And as he reads, he wants to know more. And so the Lord sent alongside him somebody to teach him. And Acts chapter 8, verse 38 tells the rest of the story. So he commanded the chariot to stand still. And both Philip, who God has sent to come alongside the eunuch, and explain to him just who he had been reading about. Because just like the Bible says, Jesus says, when you read the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, you are reading about me. And when the eunuch got some understanding of who this was it was talking about, who this was who had died, and then the eunuch was ready. And Philip, who God sent alongside him, and both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and he baptized him. Then Philip said, look at 8:37, then Philip said, if you believe with all your heart, you may be baptized. You got to believe, everybody. You got to believe that he is. And then step three is you must learn. You must learn. And the learning is taking time to open the Word of God. The learning is getting the oil. That's what we talk about. You get the oil while the oil is flowing. And the oil is flowing when you take time to open the Word of God. And as we've said in the past, your prayer before you open the book is, Holy Spirit, lead me. Holy Spirit, guide me. And God will send people alongside of you to help teach you. Acts 2:41 says this, then those who gladly received his word were baptized. And Acts 2:41 says, and on that day, about 3,000 souls were added to them. So let's talk about baptism. Does baptism mean that I'm perfect? Does baptism mean I'm becoming a part of a church body? What does baptism mean? Well, Acts 2:47, those that got baptized, and it says, and the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved.
Now, we've learned that the church is not the brick and mortar of this building. God bless us to have a structure like this, but that's not the church. You're the church. You're the church. Our church is scattered right now, and our church is in many different places, but you are the church. 1 Corinthians 12:13 says this, "For by one spirit were we all baptized into one body, and he is the head of the body, the church." It's amazing to me, all these folks going around that claim to be a Christian and not realize that to be a Christian, that you are part of Christ's body. That's where the term comes from. And then the power comes in Ephesians 4, verse 5, where it says, "There's one Lord, there is one faith, and there is one baptism." Now, I understand that. That connects one Lord, one faith, one baptism. There's one word, I think, that connects that, and that is the word obedience. Are you obedient to the leader of the faith? Are you obedient to the Lord of the faith? Is your faith in line with what he calls for us? And there is only one baptism. Jesus himself was baptized. Acts 10:38, God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power. Oh, I love baptism. I love baptism. I love baptizing those who come and choose to get in the water. I remember this young man. He's grown now. And we've had all kinds of different baptismal pools. I remember at a church that I had, and we even had the baptism pool was in the floor. But we'd fill it up, and the Holy Ghost would come, and young people would come and get into that water. There's some friends that would go and rededicate their lives to Jesus in that spot. Old and young alike would come, and they would stand in the water, and they would ask the Lord to give them the new life that he's promised. Baptism is powerful stuff. We are following the Master every step of the way. In fact, it was John the Baptist that hollered in the wilderness. He came in Matthew 3, 5, and 6. Then Jerusalem, all Judea, and all the region around the Jordan went out to hear him, and were baptized by him in the Jordan, confessing their sins. Matthew 3, 15 says, when Jesus came and John saw Jesus come, John was not willing to baptize Jesus because he knew Jesus was special, and he felt he wasn't even worthy to unleash the lashes of Jesus' shoes. Matthew 3:15 said, "Let it be so now that it is proper for us to do this to fulfill the righteousness, to fulfill all righteousness," and then John consented to baptize Jesus. You know, we said the third part of baptism is the learning part. And I love the learning part. I love to go into question and answer. We're going to do that for the rest of this service, and we're going to be done. I got question number one for you. Here it is. How important is baptism? And then the scripture tells us. Mark 16:16, we read it. Whosoever believes and is baptized will be saved. Do you want to be saved? You got to be baptized. And the only instance is that where you can't get baptized because of some physical ailment. One of the biggest examples of someone who will be in the kingdom that wasn't baptized, and many in the church know that, it was the thief on the cross. You see, the thief on the cross did not get a stay of execution. He was going to die that day. And even though he died that day on the cross, he had accepted Jesus as his Lord and Savior, and he was not taken down off the cross to go get baptized. He still died. And Jesus said to him, he said, "Today I declare to you that you will be in paradise with me." So there are instances where people who cannot go in the water for maybe some medical condition or some malady that may not be able to go in the water. And baptism is once. We have people that will come from a different faith and come in. But one thing I've learned is that once you learn new information, and you see that even in the book of Acts, once they learned new information, they had heard John the Baptist preach, and John was preaching about them getting ready, but once they learned about Jesus, they were rebaptized in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Ghost. So there is a cause for rebaptism. Once you go through the period of sanctification and you learn like you've been learning during this time of questration, during this time of quarantine,
It might be for you to go back in the water. And that's all right, because you've learned new things. Here's question number two. What did Jesus say to Nicodemus regarding the significance of baptism? Oh, I love this. Nicodemus was an old member of the Jewish leadership who believed that just by his status, he was going in the kingdom. Here's what Jesus told him in John 3:5, and it rocked his world. Jesus told him, I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of the water and of the Spirit. And that's what he told him. You're not going to be able to just go in. Here's question three, everybody. How many methods of baptism does the Bible recognize? We saw it earlier. There's only one Lord, one faith, and there's one baptism. So how was Jesus baptized? Well, Mark 1:9 says this, and it came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized of John in the Jordan. John the Baptist baptized Jesus. And look at Mark 1:10 and says, and straightway coming up out of the water. That means he had to go down into the water. And he saw the heavens open and the Spirit like a dove descended upon him, and straightway coming up out of the water. He saw the heavens open and the Spirit like a dove descended upon him. Jesus went down in the water and came up. John the Baptist, when he baptized him. So how did Philip baptize a eunuch, the Ethiopian eunuch? We saw that earlier. Well, we know that the eunuch had been reading about this Christ, and Philip was sent by God. And it's fascinating to see. When you read it, almost like supernaturally, God sent Philip there. And when Philip, after he got done baptizing the eunuch, then Philip was whisked away. So how did Philip baptize the Ethiopian eunuch? Look at it here in Acts chapter 8:38. We saw it earlier. So he commanded the chariot to stand still, and both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and he baptized him. Baptism is an immersion under the water, anybody. Anybody tell you anything else, sprinkling or all these other things? It is not biblical. The Bible interprets itself, and the Bible speaks for itself. Question number six, when Jesus was baptized by John in the Jordan River, what two significant things happened? We saw that. When he went in, look at Matthew 3:16-17. He went up out of the water, and at that moment, heaven was open. And this is one of the few times in the Bible where you can see it in spirit and word, where the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are all there together. Jesus comes out of the water, and the Holy Spirit comes in right on time like a dove and lands on him. And then there's a voice from heaven saying, this is my Son. You see that in verse 17. And the voice from heaven said, this is my Son whom I love, whom I am well pleased. That's what the Father says. So does God give us a greater indwelling of his Holy Spirit to strengthen us at baptism? Well, we see that. If you repent and be baptized, every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Acts 2:39 says, for the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. Question number eight. What assurance regarding our past does Jesus give us at our baptism? Oh, it's a high spirit around here when we have baptism. Here's the assurance that he gives in Colossians 2:12. Buried with him in baptism, wherein also ye are risen with him through faith of the operation of God, who hath raised him from the dead. Romans 6:3-4, don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that Jesus Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. That's why we become new creatures when we come out of the water. Let me talk about that for a second. You're still a sinner, even after you're baptized, but you're a sinner saved by grace. And how God handles that, because he gives us the Lord's Prayer, the daily prayer. He gives us an opportunity to bring our sins to Jesus.
If we had time to talk about the old animal sacrificial system, if you want to look back, and we did a Daniel Revelation seminar not very long ago, it gets into that. But Jesus is the Lamb that died for the sins of the world. And because of that, Jesus now is able to receive our sins, not just the sins of yesterday, not just the sins of this afternoon that you're going to do, but the sins that you're going to do next week. Being part of the new life doesn't make you sinless. It just makes you a sinner saved by grace, just like me, just like all the other Christians here. Question number 9, what are the conditions God desires us to meet before baptism? Well, we've seen it time and again. Here it is. Repent and be baptized. That's what you have to do. You got to repent. You got to have a genuine sorrowfulness for your sins. Say, Lord, forgive me for my sins. Forgive me for what I've done. In Acts 3:8-36, now as they went down the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, what must I do to be saved? Men and brethren, what shall we do? And then once they reached the water, Philip took him and said, see, here is water. And he asked the question to Philip, what hinders me from being baptized? See, Jesus told us in his last words, and we saw it earlier, to go and baptize, teaching them to observe all things that I've commanded you. And he said, lo, I'm with you even to the end of the age. So the question is, what is the spiritual significance of baptism? What is the spiritual significance of it? Romans 6:5 says this, for if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall also in the likeness of his resurrection. And then Romans 6:6 says, knowing this, that the old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, and henceforth we should not serve sin. No man can have two masters. So being baptized, we choose to follow the master of our life. Baptism is a symbol of commitment to Christ. Does it also signify commitment to Christ's church? We saw that those in Acts 2:41, those who gladly received his word were baptized, and about 3,000 were added that day, and the Lord added to the church daily. Question 12, if a person baptized once, should they ever be baptized again? Remember, we talked about that. Is there ever a cause for rebaptism? And Acts chapter 19 says this, and it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus. And finding certain disciples, he said unto them, have ye received the Holy Ghost since ye were believed? And they said unto him, we have not so much as even heard whether there be any Holy Ghost. In Acts chapter 19, verse 3, and he said unto them, unto then were you baptized. What were you baptized unto then? And they said unto him, we were baptized under John's baptism. John told us to make straight the way. John told us to get ourselves right. And then Paul said in Acts chapter 19, verse 4, here's what he said. Then Paul said, John verily baptized them with a baptism of repentance, saying unto the people they should believe on him which should come after him, that is on Christ Jesus. And look at Acts 19:5. When they heard and got new information, and when they heard this, they were rebaptized. They were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And they had been originally baptized under what John had told them. Now they had heard about the Lord Jesus Christ, and they were rebaptized. Question 13, almost done, everybody. Stick with me. What vital question does Jesus ask regarding baptism, and what command does he give? And we find that in Acts 22, verse 16. Here it is. And now, why are you waiting? Arise and be baptized, and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord, and it will allow you to have that process to begin. Final question for today, everybody. What gracious, loving invitation does Jesus give to us to accept the salvation he offers so freely to everybody? What is the gracious invitation? Here it is. We see it in Revelation chapter 22, verse 17. and the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. Let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. Oh, I love this. Are you thirsty today? Something has been happening to you, and family has seen it. People have seen it. Something has been happening to you during this time of quarantine. You found yourself on the prayer line, and you realize that once you start hearing those things maybe you've heard years ago, it starts to reconstitute your soul and light a small spark in you. The song says it only takes a spark to get a fire going. And soon, all those around will warm up in this glowing. Once you start really spending time with Jesus in the Word, you get thirsty. And it's this Jesus that calls and says, our relationship is getting stronger. Let's take it to the next phase. In fact, let's take it all the way. Even Jesus went into the water. And when he went into the water, his Father was there. The Holy Spirit was there. Baptism is a powerful time. When I go into the water with someone, we're connected. I can feel them shaking in the water as the heavens are open and the Father is pleased that another one has accepted his call to come. No matter where you've been, no matter what you've done, God has paused us so we can take a look around and see how quick this thing will change, how quick loved ones will leave us, how fear will grip people, and when man doesn't have an answer. And the only one that will have an answer to what you are so hungry and thirsty for is the one who created you, is the creator of us. So the Spirit and the bride say to you today to come. Come just as you are. Come just as you are, standing where you're standing in your living room right now. Come just as you are. Don't worry about anybody around you. Don't worry about what people say. You just stand because the Spirit of God is calling. The Spirit of God says, come. And we want to follow him every step of the way. Father in heaven, thank you for this time. You've cleared out space, and you've cleared out work, and you've cleared out activity. So I'm forced to have space for you. Speak to my heart. Speak to me during this time. And Father, when the right moment comes, I want to follow you all the way. I want to be baptized. So Lord, speak to the soul today that says yes. And if they say yes, Lord, we want to be available for them. Bless us so we can connect one with another and make it a reality. And so Lord, lead us and guide us. And we offer this prayer in your holy name we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Stay strong in the Lord.